Welcome to Alabama Grissville. I'm your host, Mike Causey, with my co-host, Donna Causey. How you doing?
I'm doing good. It's a nice day to talk and talk about history.
Yeah, and share history with all the listeners out there and, I guess, fans of Alabama Grissville and the Alabama Pioneers.
Right.
And we've got a great story today. This is about the history of the Tuskegee Institute and the founding of Tuskegee Institute and how it was founded, basically started out with a conversation.
Yeah, just a simple conversation between, surprisingly, a white Southerner and a former slave. And that's how it kind of got started. But I'll get into it. I'll tell you that on down the line.
Yeah, we don't want to get into it. Don't spoil the story before we get to it. But I do want to notice that we say a big congratulations or a big thank you, more or less, is to the all our patrons because we've reached our goal.
We need some backup music for that one.
Yep. And so we get reached our goal of 350 patrons. So really appreciate that because that kind of keeps us going on what we're doing here. That's always a great thing.
Yeah, be sure and go to the web to the Patreon site, and you'll find the links for the three books that we are giving away because we reached our goal. The three books are Vinegar and the Four Thieves, and the first Alabama Footprints book, Exploration, and Where Do I Start? The one that has the 81 questions about genealogy you want to ask all your elderly relatives. While they're still living, while they're still with us, they can give you some good advice and good information. I guess they can always give a good advice, but good information that can carry you on your own search. Advice. Yeah, they all give good advice. When you get old, you just give good advice.
it's called wisdom at that point, I believe.
Yeah, I can say that because I'm older, see.
There you go. Well, we'll go ahead and get into the story then and tell us a little bit about the history of a Tuskegee Institute and the founder. How it started off with a conversation between
a white Southerner and a former slave.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Okay. Lewis Adams was the son of a slave mother and a white plantation owner. He was the former slave that helped with this starting of Tuskegee. He didn't receive a formal education, but he could read, write, and he even spoke three languages. He acquired his knowledge by listening in on the lessons of his white siblings. As a slave, Lewis Adams was trained as a skilled craftsman in metals and leather. The Tuskegee News of May 24, 1934, reported that Lewis Adams opened the first African-American business establishment in the town of Tuskegee in 1879. He opened up as a tinsmith, a harness maker, and a shoemaker, and he advertised in the local paper. His shop was located on the square at the site where the Harrison Hardware Building stood in 1934. Afterwards, he moved to the site where Braswell's Dry Goods Store stood in 1934. He began his business in partnership with Mr. Eli Lee, a white man who finally left the business to Adams as the sole proprietor. But most importantly of all, Adams had emerged as a trusted leader in the African-American community in Macon County. He was a Prince Hall Mason as well. The white man in the conversation was Colonel Wilbur F. Foster. He had been a slave owner and an officer in the Confederate Army, and after the war, he had developed political ambitions. In the 1880s, there was a large population of African Americans in Macon County, Alabama, when Colonel Wilbur F. Foster and Arthur Brooks were trying to be reelected to the legislature. And of course, they knew they would need the African American support. So Foster went to Adams and asked him how he could get the black vote for his election. Or for his and Arthur Brooks' election, because they would have been representing their area. Foster asked him what course of action would be most likely to secure the vote. Adams thought a minute, then he replied very excitedly that they needed education and teachers in agriculture and industry. They said, if both men got reelected, if they would promise to get support for the legislature, then he would get behind them and help them get the African-American vote. He wanted to get a school started for African-American students in Macon County. Foster promised they would, and he and Brooks kept their promise. They persuaded the state of Alabama to start the school. Another white man and former slave owner by the name of George W. Kendall evidently respected Lewis as well. He was a banker and a merchant who lived in Tuskegee, and he shared Adams' vision of starting a school for African Americans in the community because they needed to be trained and as skilled workers. Campbell was a descendant of the former slaveholding aristocracy, but he and his son, Moses Campbell, wrote a letter to General Armstrong, which led to the invitation to Booker T. Washington to come to Tuskegee and teach there. Campbell and Lewis Adams joined forces, and 2 days after President Garfield was assassinated on July 2, 1881, the Tuskegee Normal School for Colored Teachers was founded on July 4, 1881. As was the custom with state school appropriations at the time, the legislature really just provided for the salaries of teachers. They did not help with buying land, buildings, or equipment. So it was up to the local communities to provide the additional funds. And that's why it was so important to have George Campbell's help, since he was a banker and a merchant. Lewis Adams and George Campbell hired Booker T. Washington, who was an alumnus of Hampton Institute, a historically African-American college in Virginia. He had been a teacher at Hampton in 1881 and was developing quite a reputation for being a great teacher. Booker T. Washington became the first principal of Tuskegee. Lewis Adams welcomed Booker T. Washington into his own home when he arrived, and he provided him with his own horse. The school was open with 30 students in a rundown church in Chaney. The following year, 1882, a former plantation of 100 acres was purchased to expand the school. Booker T. Washington considered Lewis Adams his right-hand man and established Tuskegee Institute. And many people have never heard of him. In Booker T. Washington's book, Up from Slavery, published around 1900, Dr. Washington stated that he depended constantly for advice and guidance from Lewis Adams. Lewis Adams eventually became a professor at the college, too. Since Professor Washington thought it was the most important for African-American students to learn a trade so they could become independent and self-sufficient, the school was largely built by them. The first students learned many trades, such as construction, farming, bricklaying, and cooking by building the school. They helped build Tuskegee from the ground up. Land was cleared, bricks were made, buildings built, crops to feed the students were even planted, and they even cooked their own food, so they were just self-sufficient and learning in the process. The university's campus was designed by architect Robert Robinson Taylor, the first African-American to graduate from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. By the start of the 20th century, the Tuskegee Institute occupied nearly 2,300 acres and has now been designated as a National Historic Landmark. One of the main purposes of the Tuskegee Institute was to train teachers because they needed to spread the knowledge around the state. There were not a lot of trained teachers available to African-American students. Washington urged the newly trained teachers to return to the plantation districts and show the people there how to put new energy and new ideas into farming, as well as into the intellectual and moral and religious life of the people. Washington gradually attracted notable scholars to Tuskegee, including the noted botanist and scientist George Washington Carver. After Booker T. Washington died, the second principal, Robert R. Moton, added other classes so that Tuskegee could offer regular 4-year college degrees. They didn't want them to just be trained in skills. They wanted to be competitive with a white college around in the area. This college was also advanced in women's education. What was kind of remarkable for the time, men and women attended classes in the same classroom. And in most colleges of that day, men and women did not attend classes together. During World War II, Tuskegee began training pilots. The all-black squadrons of the Tuskegee Airmen received many medals for their brave service during the war. After the war, many of these airmen and others became leaders in the civil rights movement. Tuskegee Institute continued to grow, and it's still located in Macon County, and it now it's called Tuskegee University, and a very large university. A plantation home in Tuskegee was built in 1857. Gray Collins was acquired by the National Park Service as part of the Tuskegee Institute National Site at a cost of $17,712.80, and it was fully restored and used as their headquarters. Since it was on the grounds of Tuskegee University, Tuskegee Institute was added to the National Register of Historic Places on January 11, 1980. By mutual agreement with the National Park Service, the home now serves as the residence of the Tuskegee University's president. You can go to the Alabama Pioneers website and you will see a film of the 25th anniversary, pictures from the day of the 25th anniversary of Tuskegee University.
Well, that's pretty crazy how that all started from just a simple conversation between two individuals in a challenging time, to say the least.
Right. And they all had the same interest at heart, you know, particularly the banker. You know, he was interested in trying to get the education going, too. And so it turned out well for him.
Yeah, it was all kind of a part of a political move. I guess somebody wanted to get elected, but the fruits of that and that discussion, and like you said, having the same direction, caused the Institute to be founded.
And now Tuskegee University, which has graduated thousands and thousands of students. There's also a film on the Alabama Pioneers website about, there's a story about the Tuskegee Institute, and you might want to look at that. It's a film showing their 25th anniversary, and it's got many, many pictures of the early days on the 25th anniversary, and it's on the website, so you can find it there. It's actually a YouTube film that I found that just transferred it over there.
And that in the historical, you know, Gray Columns mansion there on site, it's a great place to visit as well.
Yeah, there's another story about that. So you can just type in Tuskegee on the website, and you'll see those stories come up.
We'll go ahead and wrap it up with that. And that's our story for this episode of Alabama Gristmill. And like I said, if you want to support what we're doing, become a patron, just go to the alabamapioneers.com website, click become a patron, and we're good to go. Otherwise, you can just simply support us by telling your friends and keep subscribing and all that kind of good stuff to the podcast here. And we really appreciate it. Until next time.
Bye-bye.
Joe dancing round on his toes. Throws away his crutch and hollers. He let her go, oh, honey.